Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Ashok. I'm a research engineer at StumbleUpon with the personalization team. So we basically handle recommendations, we do data analysis, we do machine learning and engineering. Just an overlap of all these things. We are four engineers. In this talk, we experimented with something. It was just a hack that we came up with, and I'm just going to talk about that. The agenda is StumbleUpon is all about serendipity. Basically, it's about discovery. So how do you actually use content features to recommend serendipity? So these are the topics I'll be touching on. And just to give an overview, who we are, users just come in, sign up, add interests, and we recommend content for them. The content is crawled, or we get user submissions from all over the web. So we don't crawl the entire web, but we crawl certain websites. But a lot more content comes from user submissions. So when we recommend, our app is on all both desktop as well as mobile devices. So you can stumble onto any the app in a lot of places. One thing is when you look at the recommendation, we also serve the we explain why you are getting a recommendation. You can like or dislike, you can organize it, you can share it. So basically, though our core goal is recommendations, we also serve a lot of things around it, which basically facilitates an understanding user behavior and everything. So you can bookmark, you can organize, and you can share. Just a quick look at recommendations. So what is recommendations? Basically, it is matching user with content. So it's basically 4 points. You keep doing this again and again. You understand the user, understand the content, recommend, and get feedback. We serve different kinds of content. It's text, images, video, news, and different languages. The problems and challenges, basically, is understanding the user quality. Like the quality, quality meaning a user can be an expert, a guy who identifies good quality URLs early on. And there might be users who churn very well, like people who are regular stumblers, people who are, who don't come around very often. Latent interests, characterizing content. We do spam, dupe detection, spotting dead and parked pages. This is a recurrent problem. And web pages keep, they are either taken away or they just, the server is, shut down. And handling different content types, recommending images is not the same thing as recommending text, it's not the same thing as recommending news, it's not the same as videos. Recommendations, rec quality. Rec quality is something it's not the same as search quality, right? Search quality, you have a clear goal. Recommendations, you don't have a very clear goal. You think this is what the user is going to like and serve him something. But in the process, you are trying to balance relevance, diversity, serendipity versus familiarity, or novelty versus fatigue. So all these things are there. So how do you characterize them all? How do you balance them all? Managing item supply demand and also item churn. Item supply demand is basically you want to be sure that if someone is following some really niche topic, then you want to make sure that you have enough content in the topic. That's the supply demand. Churn is where you don't want to pigeonhole people into seeing the same thing over and over again. So you want fresh stuff to come up. So you need to measure that. Keep learning. Any models, any machine learning models that you deploy, everything should refresh itself. There is no one-off runs. And we have plenty of business-related rules that pose quite a challenge. The chief thing is one rec at a time. Unlike many other recommendation systems, we serve one recommendation at a time, and you basically get to focus on that recommendation completely. The user does not get to pick and choose, right? I mean, he cannot see what's going to come next. There's also another thing. If you often quoted Netflix and Amazon, all these people, they deal with curated content. If it is products come in with curation. If it is movies come in with curation. We are dealing with automated feature extraction, basically. It's purely automated. Don't show already seen content. Yes, we try not to repeat anything. Still, there are dupes sometimes that come in. The same text may be put in, maybe reblogged, or maybe reposted by another newspaper or something like that. The same news may be carried forward. Constantly changing product use cases. All of a sudden, our iOS UX might totally change. That will screw up all the way we measure users, basically. So we need to stay on top of that always. So these are some of the problems and challenges. A high-level overview of how the architecture looks. It's basically five parts to it. The yellow lines, the yellow arrows, just point out the data flow. So we go from ingestion to recommendation. So you ingest content, you do some content analysis. The cold start model decides whether it's good enough to go into the recommendation pool. And once it publishes, the offline computations as well as the online computations start updating it. So it is sort of a Lambda architecture there. And of course, you have the recommendation engine, which finally decides what needs to be put together as a recommendation. Just going a little deep into the recommendation engine, a recommendation engine is contains basically a cluster of strategies, and at any point of time, based on your the user kind you are or the mode you are in, we may choose a different strategy, and every strategy has multiple methods. This is often quoted as a hybrid approach in literature, where you are blending content-based filtering and collaborative filtering together. So methods can be collaborative filtering, methods can be content-based filtering. Each method knows how to sort, each method knows what to filter, and it gives it to the mixer. The mixer knows how to mix on both the methods, all the methods together. There are a couple of things here happening. One is the event consumers. This is a real-time, this is one of the ways in which, one of the real-time aspects of recommendation where we empower the event consumer, and that is one job or one listener that keeps looking for certain sets of user signals. we empower it to decide whether the cache needs to be replaced or not. So just preemptively, it might replace the cache, saying that in this session the user wants this or something like that, right? So something that is not something that is not very often talked about is the idea of an item lifecycle in a recommender system, and this is sort of the motivation for why we want more serendipitous recs. I'll come to that. But you have ingestion, and then you have initial recs. Initial recs is the cold start that we see here. So this is a sort of a landscape, a very oversimplified landscape of recs in two dimension. And this dimension is popularity, and this is the item's life. It goes from new to old and not too hot. So when you're cold starting an item, it is new and it is not popular. So that means it needs to collect some samples, target the right users, and that's how we know whether it's going to do well or not. And if it is doing well, it gets picked, it becomes a head rake because it's popular and it is trending. But if it is not, it just decays into something that can be picked up by tail recs. So how we qualify tail rec is something, that's where the personalization comes into picture, where you match the user and give them a recommendation that is totally only their, totally something only they will see. but the thing is, if you don't do any content-based filtering, what will happen is collaborative filtering is typically, though we do have item-based collaborative, we have item-based collaborative filtering, but we still take user signals always. So what will happen if you don't, have a method that does not use user signals, everything will converge towards head rec. So finally, at some point of time, you'll see even collaborative filtering will be serving just head recommendations. And this will just grow thinner and thinner. And finally, you'll, it totally depends on your top of the funnel. So that is a bad place to be in. So we really need, that's why we need content-based recommendation. And the other thing is, serendipity, right? So what serendipity is, let's go over to the next slide. So why we need serendipity is a user, user over time starts converging to a particular user profile. It's almost like, you know, what Steve Jobs says, right? You don't know what you want. That's pretty much is what serendipity, I mean, we try to give you something that we think you will really like, though you didn't expect it. That's the whole idea. In literature, you typically see these sort of sentences, recommend the unexpected but useful, go beyond relevance and look for interestingness. The whole idea is very philosophical, but actual point is it helps avoid tunnel vision in the sense it basically expands your horizons or whatever. But it allows exploration. It enables true discovery, which is all the more the reason why StumbleUpon should have it, because we are a personalized discovery engine. That's what we call ourselves. But the challenges are how to serve good content that is not random, is unexpected but useful, right? And how do I measure or control serendipity? I'm not saying I'm going to have answers to all of this, but one of the things that we did was there's something close to this. So serendipity, to give you a better idea, I think we've all done this, and this is what I want StumbleUpon to do. It would be awesome if you can do whatever you do in Wikipedia on the entire internet. So. content understanding. So the basic our content understanding, we do shallow parsing or very information retrieval based NLP stuff. We don't do deep parsing or it's always at the statistical machine learning level of things. So some relevant features, content features we deal with are topics, keywords, language, mind type, content type. Content type in the sense YouTube would be a video. Number of ads, number of links, responsive design. Like it's an important feature for us because we have devices, overlays, pop-ups, and lots more. In this talk, what we are concerned about is topics, basically. Topic modeling, because that's where we are going to discover topics that we want to use to make to recommend serendipitous content. And yeah, you're going to hear the word serendipity a lot in this talk. So yeah, bear with me. So topic models, what are they? They are basically language models. Basically help you understand the underlying structure of documents. It's basically for a semantic understanding of content so that you can index and make it easy for retrieval. Application is basically content categorization, which we'll cover in the next slide. Dimensionality reduction, user modeling. These are some of the very obvious applications. Content categorization. So we want to categorize documents these are some of the requirements that we have in the app. The key thing is StumbleUpon has a fixed taxonomy at the moment. We want to be able to categorize documents to a predefined topic taxonomy so that we are able to handle lot of things, like for example, if a user submits a content and doesn't categorize it, we want to categorize it correctly. If a user categorizes something, we want to evaluate whether the user has categorized it correctly. Mainly, of course, search and recommendations, definitely. And discovering related interests, we want to recommend, make your profile as rich as possible so that we can serve you better recommendations. So these are all direct ways of attacking the user. The other thing is, of course, cluster documents into broader groups. This is where the idea of serendipitous recommendations are going to come to. So we'll get there. Feature extraction. Basically, at every point of time, we are going to choose what to parse for based on the content type. If it is text, we are going to parse it in one particular way. If it is image or video, we are going to pass it in another way. Based on domain, choose how to get rid of boilerplate so that in some domains, traditional boilerplating library don't work, so we have our customized versions of boilerplating code. Detect language, choose based on the language, we choose what analysis strategies to proceed with, tokenization strategies or even engramming strategies and all that. Cleanup, remove stop words, stem. We don't always do the stemming part or even the cleaning up part. It depends on it. It works for the specific topic model. Build engrams. We cross-verify with Wikipedia. Basically, that's the Wikipedia graph, the article graph. Basically, we use Wikipedia Miner for that, and we categorize. We use all these features that we've computed and use it for categorizing. The first thing that we do, of course, we discover top for discovering topics directly, the exact thing that we have in StumbleUpon, we use a knife-based classifier. So the whole idea is very simple. Words are independently distributed, so and words are generated from one mixture. So you're going to get you've got a nice product. You know, it is a linear product. So based on the number of features that you have, you're going to compute this in linear time. The good some nice properties and some limitations it has. So it is supervised and generative. It's efficient in both training and classification. I told you classification, it is linear. It's easy to implement an online version. We can we have a version in Guillemin, which is it's an online processing library or something. Dependent on static vocabulary. So this is a limitation, right? Because we are stuck with the vocabulary we choose. Till if we want to change the vocabulary, we would need to retrain it, or we would need to, you know, do a domain adaptation or something like that. And it's again, as far as, again, coming back to the idea of the selective randomness, so-called randomness of serendipity, this doesn't quite cut it, because it has very restricted means of identifying semantic groups. That's the property of mixture model, where you think that all words occur in a mixture and are distributed in one particular way. You never think that the distribution can be different and can be different for documents and so on. So that's why the next obvious thing that we go for is use latent Dirichlet allocation. This helps us, this gives us more room to move around, basically. So latent Dirichlet allocation is simple. It uses just two parameters, and sometimes if you have topic word distributions constant, then then it becomes just alpha alone. So alpha here basically tells you how the distribution over you know, over how the topic document distributions are going to be. It's the parameter for a Dirichlet distribution, which in turn generates a topic. This is how the topic distribution looks, right? Topic document distribution looks. So the higher alpha is, it's going to be a lot flatter, and the lower alpha is, it's going to be sparse. So what we are saying is that by selecting lower alpha, we are saying that a document on an average is going to have only one or two topics, or two or three topics. While when you choose a very, very high alpha, what you're saying is it can have any combination of all the topics. The same thing goes for another parameter that is missing here. It's eta. So eta is again a Dirichlet. So again, Dirichlet, just in case if any of you don't know, is a distribution over distributions. Basically, it's every point that sampled from a Dirichlet distribution is going to sum up to one. It's going to be a probability distribution. So that is what is really cool about it. So you can every think of topic topic word matrix. So you would basically have for every topic, you would basically have word probabilities, and all of that would sum up to one, right? So that's this is the generative you know, joint probability, basically. Posterior probability. Coming back to the interesting properties, that we are interested in is, first of all, it is unsupervised and generative. I can make it supervised by, you know, putting a regression model together with LDA. It is very well suited for domain adaptation. So that means I can, at any point of, I don't need to worry about taxonomy shift. I can change the taxonomy, and I can I can pretty much run the same algorithm and get indices values for doing recommendations. This is the thing that I was talking about. This is very helpful for us. I'll come to it in some time. Can be extended to discover relations, hierarchies, etc. So basically, it gives us a lot of room to adapt topic modeling in any direction that we want to, and that is really cool. So how you evaluate LDA model is typically we use perplexity, which is just a different scaling of entropy. It is in some sense it is only it's checking out how surprised this particular model is, basically how surprised this model is having seen this new test sample, so or a set of test samples. So we also use human judgment from word intrusion and topic intrusion tasks, where we say that pick out the word or pick out the topic that doesn't go well with the others listed here. You can also, as I was saying, beta can need not be inferred. It can be static. If you have a fixed taxonomy, you can always take the Bayesian models mixture and initialize LDA. This is a set of mixtures that I have an automated thing here, so that's why it's keeping on going to the next slide. But coming back to this, this is a sample set of mixture that we got from LDA, and it's very, very good. The quality is really good. Now, what you need to know is this is how things look when you use the right, recommended beta value is 0.1, and alpha is 50 by number of topics. So that is the typical thing that was done for scientific papers, academic papers. But we want things to be a little more loose, right? So that's where you can get to play with alpha and beta. You can increase beta and you can increase alpha also a little bit, so that there is a lot more variance in the mixture. Once you do that, we then go about doing the next thing. We treat it as treat the whole idea of using. We use LDA for dimensionality reduction. We build an LDA model using the URLs in the head, and we then use the model to classify tail URLs in the latent topic space. Then we compute pairwise similarity between documents with topic overlaps. You can use cosine similarity or weighted Jaccard, but you can also use these LDA these topics and wrap them into some sort of a LSH compute Levenstein distance or Hamming distance. The cool thing about that is you would be able to interpret. You can keep. You can say that I don't put documents that are very similar in the graph. At least have two changes in the LSH, so that I have loosely similar documents but not very similar documents in the graph. Build a graph where documents make up the nodes and the similarity score make up the edge weights. Then we run PageRank. We run personalized PageRank, or in this case, it is the other name is topic sensitive PageRank over the document graph. That allows us to spot influential documents per topic and index for fast retrieval. The idea behind PageRank is again simple. It's another take on MCMC, like Markov chain Monte Carlo, Monte Carlo sampling. So Basically, you start at a random node, and all these gray nodes are basically the actual edges. Sorry, gray edges that you see, arrows. They are all actual edges, while the red ones are virtual edges. The virtual edges ensure that we visit all the nodes as much as possible. We give all the nodes a good amount of chance to be visited. Otherwise, this is the transition probability, that is moving from A to B and B to C and things like that. And you move from one node to another connected node with a probability of 1 minus alpha, and you move to something that is not connected, or you just teleport randomly with a probability of alpha. So that way, over a few iterations, you converge upon a stationary distribution. The whole idea of topic sensitive or personalized page rank is you, here for example, we initialize all the nodes with a 1 by n probability. You say that if this thing doesn't belong to this particular topic, make it 0. If it belongs to this topic, you make it a membership matrix, right? A membership vector. And so once you do that, you would basically run this so many, like how many ever topics you have, that many times. And you would get different page ranks for different topics. Now you can parallelize all these and run simultaneously. And in fact, you have another algorithm called fast personalized ranking, personalized page rank as well. But we hacked it, or we prototyped it with just the normal page rank. So basically, that's it. With this, you would be able to index these contents that are very influential in a particular topic. They are loosely connected, and they are tail ranks. So these were all controlled. We have some sort of control in the sense that if it is way too loose, we know how to tighten it by controlling the parameters. How do we evaluate it? A-B testing. We rely on A-B testing. Basically, a recommended item versus a randomly picked item. How different is the user behavior? We see that. Serendipity, like free stumbling sessions. A session is basically a group of recommendations, so we recommend sessions also, right, in some sense, because we cache things all. So we look at serendipity free stumbling session and sessions with just serendipitous recommendations and personalized recommendations, and we put them together, and we see the difference, and look at implicit explicit signals and retention. Ongoing work and future work is basically more online computations. We are aggressively looking to compute everything online. That makes that keep learning thing very easy. We don't need to worry about it at all. Model feature improvements, basically more stuff. We already use some of this, but we want to use it in the best way possible. Dupe detection improvements. Dupe detection is tough, and it's a tough problem. And for different cases, images, videos, text, you need to do different things. For news, all these things are totally different. Of course, better recommendations. This is our stack. That's the end of the talk. Any questions?
Can you go a little bit deeper into Wikipedia check?
Sure. You want more information?
Yes.
So we use Wikipedia check. Wikiminer is basically a group of Wikipedia Miner. Have you worked with Wikipedia Miner? Okay. Wikipedia Miner is an open source toolkit that was, people from Waikato University in New Zealand. The people behind Weka, I think Mallet too, I'm not sure. They came up with this, and it's really cool. It takes a Wikipedia dump and has a lot of classifiers and allows you to annotate documents using articles. And it has its own measure. It looks at the prior probability of linking, taking a surface form word, and what is the probability that surface form would be linked to one particular article, and it knows how to disambiguate and all that. So,
There was, I think it was maybe in January or something like that, a paper I'd seen that was talking about adding collaborative filtering, layering it in to typical LDA content on top of model.
Right.
Is that something that you've spent any time with trying to do? Use
We want to do that. In fact, we were doing pairwise similarity. Collaborative filtering is just using the same features. We have tried it, but we want to experiment more with it. And we don't have a model that I know what you're talking about. It's a joint model. It's an overall generative model. We would love to do that. So. It's one step at a time right
now.
Have
you tried just a collaborative model versus this, versus like a content-based model just to see how the result, would the A-B test look like?
Typically, there are a lot of other features that come into play. Like even if you're serving content-based, we always end up taking user signals. So the results are always mixed. You need both. You can't live without either. But that's it. This is one possible way in which you can use just content features alone to rank stuff. It's obvious, like Google does it. So.
Mm-hmm. Thanks. So.
Yeah. Okay. So about the A/B test tonight. So you test the productivity, and I think you use the baseline, like the random computation. But do you try other baseline, like what kind of user behavior you want to track to see if it's effective in the productivity recommendation?
So if you're asking what other user-based signals we measure? We basically, I won't be able to, communicate all the metrics because, again, these are some short-term metrics that can be gamed. And but the whole idea is we want people to stumble more and show certain, we are looking at a good. We look at things with a function of time and so on, like time you're spending and all that. But there's a lot more to it. There's a big, we have our own implicit scoring model that looks at your device, looks at you as a user, looks at the URL, and it knows how much time you would spend or like typically.
So the question I have is more related to, with the LDA model, you do a evaluation real-time out after search, or have you embedded it inside search?
So once you train the model, the evaluation is going to, of course, the human-based evaluation goes in before we settle on an initial LDA model, right? After that, there will be an evaluation constantly. There will be a polling constantly happening. So we will be looking at the perplexity. And once it goes below a particular significant, when it reaches one particular plateau or one goes up, then we decide to retry.
No, I think let me rephrase it. You're picking the item to recommend, right? So
right.
In that sense, you do it after you get, does the user get there through search, or is it just?
Oh, okay, I see. So recommendations is a problem of search. at the back, right? Just that user doesn't query, you create the query. So it is a double problem. First, you need to solve the search problem, but you also need to solve the querying problem. So you need to know, OK, if you are the user, what would you query for? So does that answer?
Yeah.
Sense of the size of your taxonomy and then the number of clusters?
Taxonomy, I think, is 500 plus. What else were you?
And then this number of topics that you're trying to attach to these nodes?
So we are, when we are looking at LDA, we are looking at keywords. Those are millions. So we are looking at millions of keywords.
OK, I think we have a last question in the back.
It was regarding your stack, your tool set. So I saw GraphLab. That's probably for PageRank. You use that?
We use GraphLab for prototyping.
Okay.
It's pretty cool because it lets you plot, and it also has some of the algorithms that we want. Of course, PageRank, we wrote our own.
Okay. Where's that actually run? Do you like
So we do use GraphLab data structures. So even though we may not use their custom thing, so their data structures are really good. S frames, and they are very similar to Panda data frames, lets us handle really big data, and it keeps it on disk, and also computes, uses all the cores, and computes really fast. So that's.
Did you write your own because of performance considerations, or just because they didn't have?
They don't have the topic sensitive page rank. Or,
oh, right. Okay, cool.
GraphLab?
Yeah.
So we are doing everything on a single machine for prototyping, but they are coming up with distributed. That's what I hear.
Well, thank you. Did you provide your Twitter handle in case they had any questions?
I don't. I can type it out.
Is the slides going to be available?
I can find out
for you.
But I think my Twitter handle is in the schedule.
Okay, great, perfect. Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you.